Rio Grande, a treasured jewel of Texas, a river with a history as deep as the canyons it has cut. Hello, I'm John Neerman, chairman of the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. Texas is proud of the Rio Grande River, and its story is one to be shared. At nearly 1,900 miles in length, the Rio Grande is the fifth longest river in North America. It flows from its headwaters in Colorado's Rio Grande National Forest, south through New Mexico's Rio Grande Gorge, and on to Albuquerque, Las Cruces, El Paso, and Juarez. About 80 miles southeast of El Paso, the river, depleted, reaches Fort Quitman and enters into what is often called the Forgotten Reach. Isolated from towns and people, in the heart of the Chihuahuan Desert, water is scarce and the river is often dry. Waters that once gave the former farming community of Riodosa its name, noisy in Spanish, are now quiet. The crumbling ruins of an adobe church bears witness to the meaning of water, and especially its absence in the arid West. But a second Rio Grande emerges near Ojinaga, Mexico, at its confluence with the Rio Conchos. The Conchos, with its headwaters in Mexico's Sierra Madres, is the largest tributary to the Rio Grande. From Ojinaga, the Rio Grande traverses desert canyons, carves an arc near the Chisos Mountains, forming the iconic Big Bend, winds through Amistad, Falcon, and Anzaldus International Dams, which feed rich farmlands in South Texas and northern Mexico, and finally reaches the Gulf of Mexico near Brownsville. Amid stark surroundings, the river gives life. It provides drinking water to communities. It enables harvests of potatoes, wheat, and barley, New Mexican chili peppers and pecans. And in South Texas, a host of row crops and leafy greens, including carrots, cabbage, onions, and cilantro. Citrus, too. The river also sustains livestock, and it supports mining, power production, and other industry. It is the lifeblood of our communities and our economies. But rivers don't adhere to political boundaries, and dividing their waters challenges political jurisdictions drawn across their watersheds. The Rio Grande is no different. The watershed of the Rio Grande covers approximately 335,000 square miles. Because the river's basin is arid and semi-arid, only half of the watershed contributes to the river's flow. With a footprint in two nations, and among them seven states, the watershed is split roughly evenly between the United States and Mexico. Also noteworthy, Mexico is downstream of the United States at Juarez, but below Fort Quitman, the relationship is reversed, and the United States is largely a downstream user of Mexico's supply. Hydrologically, it's as if the Rio Grande is two rivers, and the same is true legally. Upstream of Fort Quitman, the waters are divided internationally under the 1906 Boundary Waters Convention, and they are apportioned among Colorado, New Mexico, and Texas under the 1938 Rio Grande Compact. Dividing the waters downstream came later. The United States and Mexico joined in the utilization of waters of the Colorado and Tijuana rivers and of the Rio Grande, the agreement commonly known as the 1944 Water Treaty. The treaty establishes cooperative storage and use of the nation's shared rivers, including over 1,000 stream miles of the Rio Grande from Fort Quitman to the Gulf. Today's excursion will take us through this lower reach, traveling downstream on Texas's second Rio Grande. The 1944 treaty allocates to the United States 100% of the flow of the two main U.S. tributaries, the Pecos and Devil's Rivers, as well as numerous springs and creeks originating in the United States. The United States has also allocated 1/3 of the flows from six named Mexican tributaries. The uppermost is also the largest, the Rio Conchos. Though critical to the treaty, deliveries from the Rio Conchos have grown unreliable. Since the 1944 Water Treaty was signed, Mexico has seen significant development within the Rio Conchos watershed. Agriculture has flourished there, from the river's reliable supply as well as from the use of groundwater. This flourishing has come at Texas's expense. In its annual allocations, Mexico has chosen not to allocate water for the purposes of treaty compliance. Accustomed to this supply, Mexican farmers have rebelled at Mexico's releases from the basin's reservoirs. As a result, Mexico normally ends the treaty's five-year accounting cycles with a significant water debt, burdening Texas farmers both with a lack of predictability and a lack of water. Entering Big Bend National Park, the hydrology of the Rio Grande changes. In its 69 miles within the park, the Rio Grande has carved three dramatic canyons from the ancient volcanic uplift. Santa Elena, Mariscal, and Boquillas canyons inscribe the unmistakable Big Bend. River flows are restricted by majestic canyon walls reaching 1,500 feet above the water, walls which share their welcome shade internationally. The portion of the Rio Grande within the national park constitutes the upper section of a nearly 200-mile corridor designated as a National Wild and Scenic River. Amistad Reservoir is a gathering of waters. The Rio Grande meets Texas's Pecos River just upstream of the reservoir, near a 9,000-year-old rock painting depicting a leaping panther, which is now accessible by boat via the reservoir. The Pecos rises in New Mexico, and its flows are allocated between New Mexico and Texas under the Pecos River Compact, which was signed in 1948. Because it contributes high concentrations of chlorides, the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality maintains water quality monitoring stations on the Pecos. Amistad gathers Texas's Devil's River as well, which forms an arm of the reservoir itself. As mentioned before, the flows from these two tributaries belong entirely to the United States. Amistad Dam and Reservoir sits just above Del Rio, Texas. Completed in 1969, the dam impounds more than 3.2 million acre-feet of water. It is operated by the U.S. International Boundary and Water Commission and its Mexican counterpart, SILA. Its main operating purposes are the storage of U.S. and Mexican waters for users downstream, flood control, hydroelectric power generation, and recreation. Texas's releases from the dam are relatively consistent and primarily vary by season. Releases are generally higher during peak irrigation season, when available water is moved from Amistad to Falcon to support agriculture in the lower Rio Grande Valley. Amistad Reservoir is an important demarcation under Texas law for the management of water rights. Upstream of the reservoir, rights are subject to prior appropriation, a doctrine familiar in Western states, meaning first in time is first in right. From Amistad to the Gulf of Mexico, a unique system applies. On its main stem, water is allocated to users' accounts based on priorities established during the adjudication of water rights. But a senior water right is not absolute against a junior water right. Instead, every account holder gets a share, with some variation depending on the type of use. In January of each year, the full amount of water authorized in rights for domestic, municipal, and industrial uses is allocated. The Rio Grande Water Master allocates water for agriculture uses on a monthly basis, according to the water rights permits and the amount of water available to Texas in the Amistad and Falcon reservoirs. This is where Texas farmers often feel the bite of Mexico's irregular deliveries. Irrigation, municipal use, and mining consume the bulk of the water between Amistad and Falcon. The largest municipal user is the city of Laredo, and the largest agricultural user is Maverick County Irrigation District. The district's irrigation network was built in the 1930s and is a 100% gravity-fed system with a matrix of over 200 miles of canal laterals and extensions. Maximizing their resource, the district also generates hydroelectric power and receives accounting credit for the return flows to the Rio Grande. Here and elsewhere, the Rio Grande faces challenges related to invasive species, including elephant ear and hydrilla. The most widespread invasive, however, is the carrizo cane, which accelerates water losses due to its significant water uptake, as well as providing good cover for smugglers. State and federal agencies maintain ongoing efforts to control the cane. Falcon International Dam and Reservoir is located on the Rio Grande downstream of Laredo, Texas. With a capacity of more than 2.6 million acre-feet, Falcon is also jointly operated by the IBWC and Sela. Similar to Amistad, the Falcom Dam's main operating purposes are the storage of U.S. and Mexican waters for users downstream, flood control, hydroelectric power generation, and recreation. Most of Texas's water use on the Rio Grande occurs below Falcon Reservoir. The more densely populated Rio Grande Valley is a narrow corridor of communities, industry, and farms which have grown up along and depend heavily on the river. The Rio San Juan, a Mexican tributary, flows into the Rio Grande below Falcon Reservoir. Under the 1944 treaty, 100% of its waters are allocated to Mexico. Though Mexico consistently offers these waters to the U.S. in lieu of their treaty obligations, San Juan waters are considerably less valuable to Texas, since they cannot be captured or easily distributed to Texas users. These waters are also of poor quality, with elevated levels of dissolved solids. Poor water quality likewise is a long-standing problem with Mexico's El Morillo drain, which degrades water quality in the lower Rio Grande. High saline runoff from agricultural fields in Mexico threaten this reach, particularly during periods of low flow. A diversion structure was built in 1969, but it has been poorly maintained and has failed to adequately address the issue. Storage, monitoring, and allocation of the Rio Grande between the two countries is a dynamic and closely monitored process. And because the challenges presented by the Pecos and San Juan rivers and the Murillo drain, water quality is also closely scrutinized. 75% of the Rio Grande is currently allocated for agriculture. The concentration of dissolved solid affects the water's suitability for crops and can even lead to increased costs for municipal water treatment. Governmental agencies, including the TCEQ and other stakeholders, monitor the amount and type of dissolved solids to ensure Rio Grande water is meeting state and federal requirements. Anzaldus International Dam is located on the Rio Grande below the Falcon Reservoir near Mission, Texas. Like the Amistad and Falcon dams, it's operated both by the United States and Mexico. The dam's main operating purposes are the diversion of Mexican waters reaching the Anzaldus Reservoir via the Anzaldus Canal and the diversion of floodwaters into the U.S. floodway. The U.S. has demand for water above and below the dam. Therefore, Texas's Rio Grande Water Master Program coordinates daily with the IBWC to request releases from Falcon and Anzaldus dams to satisfy users. While the dam is not designed for storage, it can store approximately 13,000 acre-feet for uses downstream. The dam uses a rating table to establish different flow releases. As silt and various debris have accumulated over time, the reliability of the rating table has decreased. So science has now created room for the watermaster's art. Over-releases from Anzaldus result in more water going to the Gulf, but under-releases can result in the U.S. not releasing sufficient water for its users. Any negative amounts are returned to Mexico at Falcon Reservoir. Below Anzaldus, the Rio Grande flows unimpeded toward the Gulf. At its outlet, the river discharges into the Rio Grande Estuary, a small tidal river estuary, and then into the Gulf of Mexico. At least it does some of the time. With echoes of the changing flows past Ruidosa, the flows here are also not what they once were, and sandbars sometimes close the Rio Grande at its mouth. And when they do, it imperils estuarine and marine ecosystems. The Rio Grande is a jewel, no doubt. It defines the borderland region, and where it gives its precious waters, it creates life. But like so many waters of the western United States, the water course is perpetually stressed, and the specter of drought hangs like the sword of Damocles. Those who rely on its waters and who manage its flows carry a special obligation of stewardship. And may we all understand it for the treasure it is.